So we just sang about, well, we're going to talk about who God is. We say, just sang about God is holy. The definition of holy is set apart from the common, utterly peerless and above all others. In 1 Samuel 2:2, he writes, "There is none holy like the Lord. There is none besides you." And Isaiah says, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." Do we often think about the awesomeness of God and how holy he is? That, I mean, Jesus wants us to think of him as our friend, but I don't have a friend who has that kind of power other than God and Jesus, the Godhead. And so many times I think we try to bring God down to our level instead of recognizing the power that he has to offer. There's words to a song that's kind of popular right now that go, "I tried to fit you in the walls inside my mind, keep you safely between the lines, put you in the box that I've designed, and I've tried to pull you down so we see eye to eye. But how did I forget that you've always been the king of the world?" Instead of us trying to pull God down to our level, let's reach up to his holiness, and he wants to bring us to him. God is also eternal. He's never changing. He has always been and always will be. And his character throughout eternity has never changed. Never changed. You can say, well, how is that relevant to me? Billions of years later of when he, I mean, we don't even know. He just always was. But he is eternal and never changing. We can count on that. In Exodus 3:14, it says, "I am that I am." How simple. In Isaiah 57:15, "He who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy." So how is it really when God's character never changes? We can be confident of that. But that our views of God change throughout our life. He's not any different. But I believe that as we begin to sense and experience different aspects of his character along our journey with him, that he reveals additional aspects of his character to us as we learn and we grow, and we begin to see just how complex and wonderful God is. I'm thinking perhaps when we were first introduced to God, if he just said, "I am God," and all this came down and we were overwhelmed, but God reveals himself to us as we go forward. You know, about 40 years ago, there was a song that was popular, and at the time I thought it was really true. But 40 years later, I still think it's really true, and it's really about how God never changes. And I'd like to share it with you right now. Life is moving faster than it ever has before. What tomorrow brings us isn't certain anymore. So many paths from which to choose, don't know which way to run. But every road leads nowhere, every road except for one. Praise the Lord. He never changes. I come to Him. He's always there. He comforts me on every level and takes the burdens that I bear. Praise the Lord. He never changes. He's never any friends and faces come and go like ashes in the wind. Attitudes arise that I don't fully understand. The things that you can count on grow fewer every day. But when that number gets to one, the one will show the way. Praise the Lord. He never changes. I come to Him. He's always there. He comforts me on every level and takes the burdens that I bear. Praise the Lord. He never changes. He's never any and He'll be the same tomorrow as He was and is today. So these are some big words, but it takes big words sometimes to describe a big God. God is omnipotent. The definition is having unlimited power, able to do anything, almighty and supreme. In Luke it is written, "For with God nothing shall be impossible." And in Jeremiah, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me?" No, nothing is too hard for God. Do you ever think you limit what you think God can do? Are there things you think are maybe too little to ask for Him to accomplish? Something just came to mind. My administrative assistant from work was passing away from metastatic pancreatic cancer, and from the day he was diagnosed to the day he died was exactly 2 months. And I was privileged to really walk that with him. And the last week before he died, actually Rita was with me, and we went up to his apartment to visit him. And he was just sitting there. He had been hiccuping nonstop for about 48 hours, to the point where he could not breathe. and was choking, just miserable. And, you know, we had a visit, and after Rita and I left, we prayed in the car, I believe, and I knew, I said, God, it appears that it is not your will to heal Jeff, but Lord, would you have mercy on him and relieve him from his hiccups? Just relieve him from that added stress that he doesn't need. And I just prayed that his will would be done, but I put it in God's hands. And the next day I called to check in with them, and he goes, my hiccups are gone. I'm like, so when did they stop? When did they stop? And goodness, they stopped just about the time we were praying. You know, God cares about everything, even hiccups in a suffering soul. And he is all powerful. Yes, we need to pray that things are according to his will, but we shouldn't limit what we think he can accomplish. God is also omniscient. What's that? Having infinite awareness, understanding, and insight. He knows everything, always. He knows our comings and our goings. He knew us before we were born. Psalm 44:21, shall not God search this out, for he knoweth the secrets of the heart. There's really nothing that we can hide from God. That might seem a little overwhelming at times to think that God knows absolutely everything we think, everything we say, everything we do. But it's a little bit like parents and children. As you're raising your children, you know your children, and you can see them when they're ready to make a decision, and you know what they're going to choose. And you're there. You're not, most of the time, you're not going to stop them unless they're going to get into something really dangerous. But it's a learning opportunity, and you have a plan for what will happen when they make that choice. God does the same for us. In Job, he said, does God not see my ways and count all my steps? You know, it said God knows even the number of hairs on our head. And I don't know about you, but that number of hairs on my head changes moment by moment. I know that God in his infinite love knows everything about me and loves me anyway. I know my husband loves me. He says he loves me universes. But even in that depth of human love, he has no idea how many hairs I have on my head. And he's not even going to try to count, and I don't try to count his. But to know that the all-supreme being knows everything about us and wants us is just, I think, something we should embrace. God is also omnipresent, which means he's present everywhere, at all times. We are not ever alone. We are never without his presence. Years ago, I heard a saying, and it was, if you don't feel close to God, guess who moved? It wasn't God. God is still right there. But perhaps we have separated ourselves from God. In Isaiah 43:2, it says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. And David even said in Psalm 139, where can I flee from your presence? Really, he was aware God is always with us. You know, I don't know about you, but I get distracted. I have been in a stressful job, and when you're in leadership, you're constantly bombarded, and it's easy to get stressed. And in those times, I sometimes just have to stop and say, God, speak to me. I just have to breathe because I have to give it back to you because I've kind of taken it and tried to run with it myself, and it doesn't work very well. And he's always there. I can feel his presence if I ask. I ask him, just, Lord, help me to feel your presence with me because I'm blowing it on my own. Satan tries so hard to deceive us into thinking we don't have anyone who cares, that we're not worth loving, that we are alone and lonely. But we are never alone because we have God's presence. I'm sure a lot of you know that just for our family, this past year has been a trying one. First with the passing of my father-in-law, Ben, and then we had a cousin who was in an accident and passed away. Then Donald's best friend died. My father passed away, and then my administrative assistant passed away, and all those losses together at times felt overwhelming, and I couldn't understand why all of these things were happening at once. And people would ask me at work, how can you continue to do what you're doing, let's say for Jeff, reaching out for him and helping him through his death? How could you do that? But I felt called to do it, and God will give us power and strength to do whatever it is he calls us to do. And we learn through those times. We learn through those times. And there's a song called The Fire that I hope maybe might resonate with you just a little bit. I've been through a fire that has deepened my desire to know the living God more and more. It hasn't been much fun, but the work that it has done in my life has made it worth the hurt. You see, sometimes we need the hard times to bring us to our knees. Otherwise, we do as we please and never heed him. But he always knows what's best, and it's when we are distressed that we really come to know God as he is. You see, sometimes we need the hard times to bring us to our knees. Otherwise, we do as we please and never heed him. But he always knows what's best, and it's when we are distressed that we really come to know God as he is, as he is.
Another aspect of God is that he is creator, and we can see glimpses of him through nature. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, All things were created through him and for him. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. So every day we can see in our beautiful Pacific Northwest the nature around us and take joy from it. And we can see the changing of the colors of the leaves and the changing of the seasons and take in the smells of nature. And we can take that all in, and sometimes we can appreciate it more times than others, and sometimes we can just take it for granted and brush it aside. But at times it's good to take it all in and say, wow, God created all of this for our enjoyment and for his, and he created us too. And he cares about all of us, even the little aspects in our lives, down to the smallest ant, to the hugest big earthquakes, any aspect that happens in the world, he cares about. God is in the details, and we can see the beauty around us, and it's amazing how we can see the complexity of this world through the human body and for all the other interworkings of this world. How can you not see God in the world around us? But ask the animals, and they will teach you, or the birds in the sky, and they will tell you, or speak to the earth, and it will teach you, or let the fish in the sea inform you. Which of these does not know the hand of the Lord has done this? In his hand is the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind. Job 12:7-10. Creation knows that God created them, and we just have to go out and observe it. Even as Jesus was here on earth, creation knew that he was the master and creator when he commanded the seas to cease and the wind to stop when he was with his disciples on the sea. Another thought that puzzles me is how can atheists and evolutionists just say it all happened by chance and under perfect conditions when the world is so detailed and precise in how they work and it can be done by chance? If God, the divine artist, gives the simple flowers that perish in a day their delicate and varied colors, how much greater care does he have for those that created in his own image?
I ask you to stand and sing this hymn with us, all creatures of our God and King, in praise to our Lord.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Alleluia, alleluia. The burning sun with golden beam, the silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Worship him in humbleness. Praise the Spirit three in one. Oh, praise him. Oh, praise him.
Seated. I think as Laura talked about the complexity of the human body, I don't know how many of you have heard this, but as people have examined how the human body is put together, there appears to be a glue that holds our bodies together that's called laminin. And under a microscope, that substance, laminin, looks like a cross. You know, Jesus holds us all together. Right now, Rita is going to give us a glimpse of Jesus.
I'm almost certain that each one of you would like to be able to see Jesus and to actually, or at least have an actual picture of what he looked like when he was here on this earth. At times we might even cry out, if I could only see his face, my faith would be strengthened. I'd like now to attempt to paint for you a picture of Christ in words, because I believe we can see Jesus in a much better sense than most of us have ever realized. If we begin with his race, Jesus was a Jew. And in the region where he was born and lived, you begin to take on that someone would have a darker complexion and probably dark eyes and dark hair. According to the Bible, we know that Jesus spent much time working and walking outdoors in the intense sun of the Middle East. This would have begun to weather his skin even when he was very young. As the son of a carpenter, we can be sure that Jesus' muscles were well developed with strength required to hew and shape wood. We are told that Jesus' overall physical appearance was nothing noticeably different from anybody else around him. But his eyes. Can you begin to think how many times the Bible says Jesus turned and looked at him? There were many times Jesus merely looked at someone, and that person knew immediately that Jesus knew him. Those eyes could see through the outer perfectionist leaders that strove to portray Jesus that appeared perfectly holy, but on the outside they were filthy. Those eyes shone with an intense feelings, with love, conviction, pity, deep sadness, disappointment, and joy. His eyes reflected the very heart of God to everyone who gazed into Jesus' eyes. A single look from Jesus caused men to change their direction, the dirty to become clean, the sick to be made well, and the women to reveal their deepest shame. And then his hands of Jesus, so rough and calloused from his years of hard work in the carpenter shop, yet parents thronged around him just to have him place his calloused hands on their children. Those hands must have gently reached out to heal the sick and touch the eyes of the blind and raise a child from death and to calm anxious souls. The voice of Jesus must have been filled with love and caring, gentle as a whisper at times, yet mighty enough to be clearly heard by more than 5,000 people gathered out in a field. His voice claimed the power of his Father to raise the dead, to calm the angry seas, and to rebuke those who were teaching falsehood. People longed to be his presence and followed him wherever he went. Even in the darkest hours, the peace and joy of the Father filled Jesus' countenance. Jesus came in contact with all manner of society, the rich, the revered, the cast out, the rejected, those who were mentally ill or possibly possessed with demons. Jesus clearly did not hesitate to confront anyone about sin, but it was very clear that although he hated sin, he loved the sinner. Jesus loved the sinner so much that he gave his very life, dying in our place so that he could someday be reunited in eternity with those that he created and that he loved so much. Truly Truly, perhaps now you can imagine how Jesus might have looked here on earth, although the true picture we have in the end is not about his physical being, but his very presence that shone with the light and love of his Father's character. Jesus said, "If you've seen me, you have seen my Father." I cannot prove exactly how Jesus looked when he was here on earth, but I know and follow Christ as my Savior. He gained victory for sin for us, and he died at Calvary. I have felt that beautiful love of Christ, and I stake my very life, claiming that Jesus is real. He is risen and alive forevermore, and someday I will see him face to face.
It does us good to spend time pondering and reflecting on the life of Jesus. And I don't think we'll ever go wrong if we keep the face of Jesus before us. So many times we're distracted by the people around us and the situations around us that anger us and frustrate us, and we're hurt by that. But we're really to look up continually, up to Jesus, and we'll never be disappointed. Could you please, you can stay seated, but could you please join me in singing, "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus"?
Is that he is one who listens and hears our prayers, and I felt his presence in my life through prayer. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us, and if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we asked of him. 1 John 5:14 and 15. Part of prayer is being honest and open with God and talking to him as you would a best friend. It doesn't have to be fancy or use big words like Jesus talked about it, to the Pharisees, saying they were showing off through their prayers and doing more as a show than necessarily through a personal conversation with God. God always listens to our prayers, even if we don't hear his response, and he cares about every part of our lives. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and your minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Philippians 4, 6, and 7. I know for me personally, I have a tendency to overthink things and to worry about different aspects. And at times, my mom has to remind me, whose hands do you need to give these burdens to? And I say, God. And that is something we all need to remember as we're going through our lives and going through our burdens, to give them to God, even though they may be preying on our minds, that we need to give them to him. And that will bring peace to us as you give it into God's hands, even if we don't see an answer right away. Oftentimes, we don't understand or see God's answer to prayer until we look back on an experience. God knows our lives from beginning to end and has a far better plan for our lives than we do. God's plans are to prosper you and not to harm you. I have a song that I like to share with you by Hilary Scott called Still, that talks about giving over control to God and listening to him.
Sometimes I still try to take control, 'cause I get scared when I can't see the end, and all you want from me is to let go. Your parting waters making
God is love. John 3:16-17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. You know, there's another verse in the Bible that says, greater love hath no man than he lay down his life for a friend. But Jesus came to this earth and laid down his life for sinners, people who are enemies, who are actively acting out against his will and character. He came because he loves every single one of us and wants to be with us. He created us. He created us because he wanted to spend time with us. And sin has separated us from God. When he came to this world, he came, it's hard to understand, but fully God and fully man. And he came in the image of a man. As he was here on earth, his work was to really reveal what his Father was like and to help those people to see God's love in action. But you know, when he was here, he was human. He experienced human emotions, grief, anger, frustration, loneliness. And he stayed connected to his Father, and that's what gave him strength. But he really experienced the things that we experience. And I've said this in our Sabbath school class before, but what never ceases to just overwhelm me is that when Jesus went to the cross, I mean, he was always connected to his Father. It talked about how much he spent time in prayer, and everything was a back and forth relationship, just this constant connected to his Father. But when Jesus went to the cross, he had to take upon him our sins. And in that moment when he took our sins, he personally experienced the separation and blackness that comes between us and God because of our sin. He called out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He had faith, but the feeling of that separation from God was too much. It broke his heart, literally. I believe that Jesus is there in heaven. And when they're talking about us, Jesus stands there and he says, I know their heart. I've been there. I know what they're facing. I know how it feels to be separated from the light of you, O God. And I stand in their place. There is nothing like the love of Jesus. And you know, when Jesus came to this earth, it didn't mean when he returned to heaven, he was just going back to the same old, same old. Jesus personally has been changed forever and for eternity by having become a man to pay the price of our sin. He gave that up for eternity. And how can we turn down that love? God and his love is often visible to others through us. And I would like to invite Sharon up to tell us about a situation where truly someone was used to bring her closer to the Lord.
Thank you, Cheryl. I would like to talk to you about my journey with God. It started a little over 3 years ago. I lived in a mobile home park, and I met an amazing woman. I thought she was cool. She was nice to me. We would walk, and she would talk about her church, and sometimes I would ask her questions, and she'd be very nice and answer me, and we'd go on, and And then one day, she gave me this beautiful book I had never seen in my life. It was called Desire of Ages by Ellen White. I started that book, and I could not put it down. All of a sudden, things I never knew about, I learned. I didn't know why Sabbath was so important. Well, to me, it was just another day where you go sing songs, and you talk to the people, and you go home. That was it. And then to suddenly read that Jesus is coming to get us. I thought, oh my goodness. But it is so amazing and so wonderful and so beautiful, this journey I'm on. One day I was at her house, and we walked out her back door. She lived in a mobile home. And we were talking, and I went down the steps, and I turned to tell her goodbye and thank you for the visit. She was smiling at me. She always smiles at me because she doesn't know what else to do with me. So I looked up at her and she said, would you like to go to church with me? I said, to church? You want me to go to church? She said, yes. I said, are you sure? Because I might embarrass you and I talk a lot. Oh, she said, you'll be just fine. And I stood there a moment and I said, okay, I'll go to church with you. And behind her head, there was no sunshine in the carport. This beautiful white light was surrounded right behind her body. And I stood there in awe and wonder, and I thought, that's my angel. My angel is talking to me. So I started going to church with her, and over time I decided, I like this church. The first day I come, little Rita came up. This little lady, I had no idea who she was, hugged me, and I just stood there. I didn't know what to do with my arms. And it was the most thrilling and exciting feeling that someone would come up and be so kind to me. In time, I decided, I want to join this church. This is where I belong. God loves me. These people are so nice. And so I decided to be baptized. And that was wonderful because it was my decision. And I got to go buy a new special dress for the day. So I was baptized, and September 20th will be 3 years of the day of my baptism. And I'm on such a wonderful journey, filled with thank you, filled with love and happiness and trust. And I am amazingly not depressed, not anxious. I'm finally at peace, and my family loves it. So thank you all. Thank you, my special friend. I won't say your name because when I talk about her and brag about her, I embarrass her, and she always says, Sharon, don't say my name. So I won't say her name, but she knows who she is, and she knows how much I love her. Thank you.
So by that example, we can really take to heart, don't shine so others can see you. Shine that through you, others can see Jesus. God is trustworthy. We can always trust him. Psalm 111, verse 7, the works of his hands are truth and justice. All his precepts are sure. And in Samuel, it says, now, O Lord God, you are God, and your words are truth, and you have promised this good thing to your servant. And that means, and you can trust that you're going to get it. You know, sometimes, most times, it's not in our timing. And that's where faith comes in, and trying to stay in a state of peace and trust, and knowing that God's timing is perfect. My timing is not perfect. You may not always feel like God has an answer in store for whatever it is that you are facing, but you can trust him. We just have to be willing to let it go. Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. 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 Our God is also in control. Proverbs 19:21 says, many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand. Romans 8:28, such a popular verse, but think about it. And we know that for those who love God, all things, work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. At my work in the last couple years, I've been surrounded by some people I would refer to as bullies who have really kind of wanted to be the boss of me, but they weren't. I reported to someone else who I trusted very much. And it has been an ongoing trial of stress. And I've worked at the same place for over 16 years, and I started asking, Lord, I know you have used me here. I know this is where I have been because you've asked me to be there, because of all the people I've come in contact with and been able to
some I've even been able to introduce God to. But Lord, you have something else for me, but I couldn't see any possibilities. And then I said, Lord, if I'm supposed to stay here, then Father, I pray that somehow you will give me your Holy Spirit to see how I should deal with this problem, because I can't humanly take it anymore. Well, when we were on vacation a few weeks ago, second morning of vacation, my cell phone rang really early, and it was my current boss, the president of the hospital, and she said, Cheryl, I'm calling you. I'm sorry, but I wanted to let you know I'm leaving. I'm taking a position in Southern California. And that was a blow to me, because we worked together very closely, and I trusted her. And I thought the rest of that day, oh my goodness, how can I face what I'm going through without her? But I trust. I will trust. God's always been there. And the next morning, again, really early, my cell phone rang. And it was a chief nursing officer of a different hospital calling me. She got my number from someone and said, we have a position open and we've heard about you and your leadership style and we would love you to come and join our team. Are you willing to apply? And I went, wow. Anyway, I said, sure. Yeah, we'll be home. Anyway, it was kind of like God going, whack, I told you I had it. I told you I had it. And so sometimes his answers don't come like that. But he had it. He had the situation in mind. And not only is the job that I'm taking going to be a 30-minute commute instead of an hour and a half to 2-hour each way commute, so I can actually have time in my life, I hope, to serve this church even more, because sometimes it takes 2.5 hours to get there or back. So I just say, God is in control. We need to trust. He has the answers. It isn't necessarily what we think might happen, but we can trust that he is in control. Please stand and sing with us one of our favorite songs, My Savior, My God. I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior, that he will leave this place on high and come for sinful men to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God, he's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God, he's always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me bring my strength, my soul is from this spring, that he who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior, that he would leave his place on high and come for sinful men to die. You counted strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. My
Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be.
Said, you're going to have to sing again in just a second. Our God, thank God, is merciful. He knows us, He loves us, and He wants to give us mercy and grace. But God demonstrates His own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Right now, I'd like you to continue standing and sing as we sing, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, He for still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate, on earth is not His equal. Death, the Spirit and the gifts are ours through Him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever.
Martin Luther wrote that song. He took it from Psalms 46, 1 through 4. He was going through persecution and trials, and he called upon God and looked at Him as our rock and fortress, a sure strength. And Psalms says, God is our fortress and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at His swelling. The world as we now see it is grossly misrepresents both God's character and His original plan for this planet his people. Sin has so degraded Earth's ecosystem that many can scarcely see an image connected between this world and the paradise described in Genesis 1 and 2. Even the life of the believer, who must do battle with the world, the flesh, and the devil, does not accurately portray God's original plan. God has planned for the redeemed a world untouched by Satan's influence, a world in which God's purpose rules, in which we can finally see the true representation of his character once more. God's character is shown through truth. His strength and refuge are comfort. As we see the end of the great controversy approaching, if we will choose to follow Jesus Christ, we will be given faith to carry on until the end. Christ overcoming Satan is the climax to Earth's history. The greatest gift of God's great love promises us a hope of a magnificent future. In his strength, we are called to rise above the sinfulness of the world. Christ, our Savior and King, will soon return to redeem us and take us to live with him in heaven and finally in the new earth. His promise to create for us. Let us never give up this precious hope. God is coming to take us home with him. And it says in John 14:3, "And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." God promises that he's going to make all things new. We see that in Revelation 21, 1 through 4, a great hope and promise that was shown to John. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth have passed away. The sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a great loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eye, and death shall be no more.'" God is victorious. The end is a great, precious gift that we are looking forward to. In John 16:33, Jesus tells us, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world."
Stand one more time and singing the closing song, "We Have This Hope."
We have this hope that burns within our hearts, hope in the coming of the Lord. We have this faith that Christ Hallelujah, Christ is King. that burns within our hearts. Hope in the coming of the Lord. We believe the time is here when the nations far and near shall awake and shout and sing.
Is going to dismiss us with prayer, and offering will be taken at the doors.
Please bow your heads.
Dear Heavenly Father, we hope that we have seen some glimpses of your character, the magnificence of your being, and the power and glory of your being with us in the Christ's death and the Holy Spirit, that you are victorious, and that we hold true to these promises. Now, as we depart, we ask for you to bless us and keep us safe in the week to come, and that you may work through us in your will. Amen.
We have come to this house.